out of 20, 34 questions, I think 24 had come from RC, right people? 24 were from RC. So what percentage is it? What percentage of questions come from RC? Roughly 70%, right? Roughly 70% of the paper comes from RC. That means that 70% of your effort should go towards RC, right? I mean, that is what it means, right? So if you ignore everything else and focus only on reading comprehension, the chances are that you can score good marks. I know students who attempted only RCs and have managed to get 97 percentile. Imagine people, 97 percentile only by attempting RC. A student, Prateek Gupta, had got 66% in CAT 2015. And then when he wrote CAT 2016, of course, I helped him a lot. He was very eager to learn and to improve. And in CAT 2016, his ZAT verbal percentile was 97, if I'm not wrong. So this is the improvement. The ZAT percentile was 97. The CAT percentile was 96 or 97. I don't remember exactly what the figures were. But this is the kind of improvement. How to improve? Well, that's it. There are certain questions that cannot be answered in theory. People, please understand. When you say how to improve reading comprehension, you have to sit with it. You have to start solving the questions. You have to basically keep on. You have to find good questions. You have to find good solutions, so that the technique used by the person at the other end can be used by you to arrive at the right answer. That is precisely when we talk of RC, we can talk of lots of things, you know, read this way, read that way. But eventually it all comes down to how well you comprehend and how well you practice. Okay, so let's not talk much about what to do. Let's see how to do, correct? Because that is a better way of approaching a problem. The moment you start discussing how to do, you start learning the lessons, right? So let's go to the very first passage here. And it's a very, I deliberately take short passages in my sessions because short passages fit on the screen. And secondly, you have enough time to, you should always start with short passages. And there is always this misconception. People think that short passages are easy, long passages are tough. You should look at the questions first and then you should go and read the passage. I think there can be a mix of strategy. I mean, you can adopt a strategy depending upon what is your comfort level, right? So I would say that if I as a student, I always read the passage first. The reason is that if I read the questions, then the question starts weighing on my mind. The comprehension goes for a toss. I mean, this is what happens with me. So I first read the passage, and then I come to the question. At least one reading I definitely give to the passage to get a fair idea as to what the passage is all about. Now, before I go ahead into the technicalities, I would like to explain to you something, that questions, RC questions, correct, can be of different categories. Okay, RC questions can be the first kind is okay stated. Okay, whose answers are stated. Whose answers are, what do you mean by stated, people? The answers are given, isn't it? And then there are RC questions whose answers are to be inferred. This is the first level of difficulty. Now, to be inferred, or whose answers are implied, or whose answers are indirectly given. Okay, so basically, in short, it is not stated. In short, if I have to club all this together, I would say it is not stated. And the other is that it is stated. Now, many of you get a feeling that it is easy to answer or find an answer to a question whose answer is stated. So if the answer is stated, it is easier, right? And if it is not stated, then it's difficult, right? But there are passage, or there can be passage, in which the stated things are very difficult. I mean, it will really frustrate you because it is so discreetly hidden that it's very, though the answer is clearly there, it is very difficult for you to find the answer. This is more about comprehension. This category is more about comprehension. Okay. It is more about comprehension. It is more about reading between the lines. People understand. When you want to infer something, you must be good with reading between the lines. Only then you would be able to arrive at the answer. So when I say that if the answers are not stated, then you must be good at reading between the lines to arrive at the answer. So here, comprehension is the key. Understand, people. Here, comprehension is the key. And therefore, without understanding, you cannot mark the answer. Here, you must find the answer. If you find the answer, you are the boss. You have got it. So finding the answer needs a different approach. And comprehending the passage needs a different approach. So a question which is basically more about factual in nature, or a question which is factual in nature, you have to hunt for the answer. And the question which is more about inference and, you know, what the author is implying or reading between the lines, you have to basically comprehend. So when you are hunting, you have to use a hunter's approach. And when you are comprehending, you have to use a scholar's approach. So broadly speaking, if I speak about the strategy in RC, there are two broad strategies that I adopt. My first strategy is sometimes I become a hunter. I read the question. I know that the question is factual in nature. I go to the passage and I try to find the answer. Then my other strategy is sometimes I become a scholar. What do you mean by a scholar, people? Hunter is very clear to me. I read the question. I know that the question says which of the following is not mentioned in the passage. So I go to the passage. I start finding and I... A scholar basically has to be patient. He has to be patient. He has to be careful. Reading line by line. Correct. So the scholar has to be patient. He has to be careful. He has to go line by line. He has to be very, very cautious. The hunter has to be swift. You are hunting, right? So when you are swift, you are a good hunter. So for example, when you have passages in IIFT, people understand, what kind of approach do you need? You need a hunter's approach. Why? You read the passage, you read the question, you go back to the passage. Straight away start finding the answer. There are many, many kinds of questions in the same passage which need two different strategies. Sometimes direct approach. Yes, you read the question, you start finding the answer. Straight away, there is no need for you to beat by the bush. Then there are passages in which, okay, what is the central idea of the passage? Do you think the answer is given in the passage? I mean, if I ask you, if I have to categorize the central idea of the passage, do you think the answer is given? So, there are two broad categories of questions. Questions of factual nature. I'm just using a rough English, people. Questions of factual nature. Questions of, yes, I will come to that, people. I will come to all your questions. Questions of inference nature. Okay, I'm just using this broad word. Factual nature. So factual nature, and you have inference nature. Correct? When you have factual nature, you look for the answer. Okay? And when you have questions of inference kind, you carefully read the passage or that part of the passage where you think the answer is hidden. There is no need for you to read the entire passage. Now, what kind of questions are factual in nature? Questions that demand information. Question that demand information. That's it. For example, which of the following is required to solve problem of political unrest? So the author must have mentioned it in the passage. You go and start hunting for it. You find the answer and you mark it. I mean, it's as simple as that. You can basically make out that this question demands information. This question demands comprehension. So questions of inference kind, what is the central idea of the passage? You will not find the answer. What is the central idea? What is the tone of the author. You will not find the answers explicitly given. Then the third kind is what can be inferred about X, Y, or Z. The fourth kind is what does the author imply, right? The fifth kind is what is the purpose of nth paragraph, right? The way we have purpose of the entire passage, we have the purpose of a paragraph as well. What is the purpose of second paragraph? What is the purpose of first paragraph? Whatever it might be. Then what would be the source of the passage? Have you seen this question, people? What could be the source of the passage? Is it an editorial column? Is it from a magazine? Is it from a newspaper? Is it from a research journal, right? So the answers are never given, people. The answers are never given. You have to find, you have to guess by comprehension as to what could be the source of the passage, right? Then the seventh category is what could be the title of the passage, right? You will come across questions like these as well. Give a suitable title to the passage. And then the question could be, you know, what could be the author's profession? I mean, you have to guess the author's profession, whether he's a scientist or whether he's likely to be a historian. So these are the different varieties of questions. I think my voice is clear. These are the different varieties of question. The voice is not clear, people. I think, what about the others? Can you all hear me? I mean, I think the signal here, okay. Profession basically means the author is a seen eight varieties of question now, correct? The central idea, the tone of the passage, what can be inferred, what does the author imply? Eighth one is what is the author's profession? Many a time, you know, there would be a question which would say, what is the author most likely to be? Then the options would be the author is most likely to be a historian, to be a literary critique. He is most likely to be a journalist. You have to guess from the content of the passage as to what could be the author's profession. I hope you are following me, people. So the point here is, the point of giving all these eight questions to you is that these are the, where does this passage most likely appear? Right. Yeah, whatever. I mean, you can have an n number of questions, right? One question that has recently started coming in CAT is, what could be the next sentence of the paragraph, next sentence of the passage? This question became very common in CAT 2012-2013. My students used to come and tell me, sir, this kind of question. Yes, they will give you four options. We will come to that, people. See, we will come to this. Don't worry about how can we guess the profession. These are the varieties of questions. And as we take the questions, you will get to know how to basically guess the answer, how to arrive. These are the varieties of questions. Correct, people? So let's go a little above here, and I will go to the first part now. Now, the factual nature can be anything. Factual, anything can be factual in nature. For example, if the passage is about a particular hormone and its impact on the brain, then the question could be that the hormone XYZ has all kinds of effects except which of the following. So you can say, yes, I have to look for the answer in the passage. And sometimes it might be very painful. It might be very painful for you to find the factual data from the passage. Because if the information is dense and lots of facts and figures are given to you, then please understand, people, the factual question may not be that easy. And many a time, the inference questions are easy to get through. Because you have comprehended the passage, so it's quite possible that you might get all the answers correct. Okay, so before I go to the next part, let me come to the other part, which is what are the different kinds of passages? I am a part of a group in which people discuss different articles, and they discuss the tone of the passage. They discuss the summary of the passage. What are the kinds of passages? Yes, people, can you tell me? You will give me a hell lot of answers, right? This kind, that kind, you know, X, Y, Z. Okay. Let's keep it very, I mean, philosophy is a subject matter. But what are the kinds of passages? Of course, many different kinds of historical philosophy. Broadly speaking, if I have to say, what is the tone of the passage or tone of the author, right? Then you will say, okay, we can have many answers here. That could be narrative, that could be, I will come to that people, narrative, and then that could be descriptive, right? And there could be many, many different types of, you know, narrative, descriptive, analytical, critical, laudatory, ironical. I will give the group. Okay, so fine. But then, broadly speaking, the tone of the author, you people read reports, right, in the newspaper? You read the front page news, right? What is the tone of that? The tone of all the front page news, what is that tone? Is it factual? Is it descriptive? It is narrative? Or is it objective? Yes, people? It's objective, right? What do you mean by objective? You write what you see. That is objective. You write what you see, not what you feel or think or like, correct? You write what you see. So whatever is happening in front of you, you start writing it down. That is objective. And most of the report writing done in the newspapers and magazines are basically objective. But when you go to the editorial column, they are factual. Objective is factual. Understand, people. You are representing facts and figures without actually, if it is representing facts and figures, it is factual. If it is just describing, you know, event, then it could be narrative. But broadly speaking, the author either participates in the discussion or he does not participate. These are the two broad categories. If the author participates, then I would look for that point in the passage where he participates. So if I'm writing something, it's quite possible that suppose if I say that yesterday the Prime Minister announced a very good scheme for the farmers, okay? Or yesterday the Prime Minister announced a scheme for the farmers. Which is more objective in these two sentences? The Prime Minister announced a very good scheme, or the Prime Minister announced a scheme for the farmers? The second one, right? Because in the first one, by using the word very good, I am basically giving my opinion. So the second one is objective. The first one basically is a mix of objective and opinionated sentence, right? I hope you're getting this. What is the difference between what is objective and what is not objective? So people, you must always look where the author is participating in the passage. It's quite possible that the author has written the entire passage without participating in the discussion. That means what? He is quoting someone else's opinion. He is quoting the third guy's opinion, but he is not quoting his opinion. And therefore, the author is basically pouring opinions from different sources and he is just analyzing them. My point is that you must always look out for that part of the passage where the author has participated. And the moment the author participates, you will get to know his tone. Because if I'm participating, that means if I'm basically adding something of my own, that means it could be good, it could be bad, it could be biased, it could be unbiased, it could be anything, it could be insightful, we don't know. So there could be many, 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 many different shades to that opinion. So if you want to know the tone of the author, you first go to that part of the passage where you see that the author has participated. If the author has not participated, then the tone is objective, dispassionate, unbiased. But if the author is participating, then the tone could be laudatory, critical, the tone could be, you can say, biased, the tone could be acerbic. You can take N out of polemic. It could be 20 different names. We don't care about the names. We must see that part of the passage and then give a name to it. Because it's not open-ended, you will be given four options. And out of that four, you have to pick the best, which is the tone, okay? So shall we go to the passage straight away, people, without wasting much time? Take the first question, people. A cracker of a question. Take the first question and I will give you 3 minutes to 4 minutes. People, let's have a very, very good discussion. It's going to be a cracker of a session today. Just have a look at it and I will give you 3 minutes. Read it carefully and we will discuss it extensively. Don't worry about that. Abhishek says, analyzing a scholarly study. Saurav says D. So we already have three answers. We have had C, we have had D, we have had E. Anyone with A? Okay, so Pulkit, no. Someone, Kunal has given A. Pulkit has given B. So we have all the five possible choices, right? So let me read the passage. In the forces of production, what is this, people? It's the name of a book, right? It's the name of a book. In the forces of production, David Noble examines the transformation of the machine to industry as the industry moved from X to Y. Right? This is the first sentence. So the author says what is happening in the book. Noble writes from a Marxist perspective, and his central argument is that management in its decision to automate conspired against labor. This is the central. So who is basically saying this, that management conspired against labor? Who's saying this, people? Is it the author of the passage or is it David Noble in his book? It is David Noble's, right? It is not. Noble is writing in his book that management conspired. How do you come to know? Noble writes. That means this is not the author's opinion. This is the opinion of David Noble. Noble fails to substantiate this claim. Who says this, people? Noble fails to substantiate this claim. Voice gone. Can you hear me now? Gone. I think it's coming back. Not clearly audible. It's there, right? I think it's clear now. I will come to these people now. Noble fails to substantiate this claim. Who says this, by the way? The author, right? That means the author's attitude towards Noble is negative. Right, people? Am I correct? Noble fails to substantiate this claim, although his argument is impressive. The author's attitude towards Noble is negative. How? Because he says Noble fails to substantiate this claim. What is this claim, people? Where is this claim mentioned here? This claim is mentioned here that management, look at this, management in its decision to automate conspired against labor. This is the claim. And the author says Noble fails to substantiate this claim, right? Then we will go to the next. In automating, the industry moved to computer-based digitized numerical control rather than, who is saying this? This is in Noble's book, right? This is in Noble's book and the author is discussing that. Correct. Look at this now. Although both systems reduce something, so more or less, although both systems reduce reliance on skilled labor, Noble clearly prefers RP, right? With its inherent acknowledgement of worker skill. Unlike NC, its programs were produced not by engineers, but by skilled machinists who recorded their movements. However, Noble's only evidence of conspiracy is that although the two approaches were equal, right, management chose NC. From this, he concludes that automation is undertaken not because of it, but because of that. So what is the passage all about, people? The passage is that the author is discussing David Noble and what he has mentioned in his book, right? Automation versus human labor. So what is the author of the passage primarily concerned with? My point is Do you see anywhere a political decision or a political position? No. So A goes out. Is the author examining a management decision, or is he analyzing the book and the book is examining a management decision? Is the author examining a management decision, or is it the book that is examining a management decision? So can I say even B goes out? Because the author is analyzing the book and the book is analyzing something. So C so far is the winner. Explaining a trend in the automation. Is this happening in the passage, or is it happening in the book forces of production? So it is not happening in the passage. Nowhere the trend in automation has been discussed. The passage is discussing the book. So even D goes out. Is the author discussing the history of an industry in the passage, or is the book discussing something similar? Don't you think C is the best choice? That means what? In the passage, you can have multiple players. You must understand where is the author's stand. Where exactly is the author of the passage standing? He talks about A, he talks about B, he talks about C. But out of this A, B, and C, where is the author? What is the author's point of view? That is very important, people. And once you spot that, you have spotted the author's tone, you have spotted the author's purpose, and you have spotted the central idea of the passage. Shall I go to the next question, people? So this is the passage here. You can go to your Facebook, you can download the, according to information in the passage, the term de-skilling refers to what? It's a factual question, right? The term de-skilling refers to what? Look at this. De-skilling, and it says the use of technology to replace skilled labor. So the dash basically shows that de-skilling is nothing but the use of technology to replace skilled labor. So if that is the straightaway answer given to you, then what could be the best choice here? Exclusion of skilled labors, right? Is it clear now, people? I think the voice is clear now. The signal. Okay, so what is the answer for these people? The answer is E, right? Any exclusion of skilled labors, or is it B, people? Substitution of mechanized processes for labor formerly performed by skilled workers. What is the difference between these two options? These are two very close options. Exclusion of skilled workers from participation, or is it substitution? Which is the better word, people? What do you mean by replacement, people? I will come back to the passage. The use of technology to replace, right? So can I say replacing is substituting, right? If I look at this passage, people, you don't move away from the passage. De-skilling basically means the use of technology to replace skilled labor. And if you go to the question here, it says that substitution of mechanized processes. Is it development of automated technology, and are you excluding the skilled workers from participation, or are you substituting mechanized processes? The passage is more about substitution because of the word replacement, people. What is directly visible to you should be taken as the biggest hint. The answer should be B, not E, because E is not... What do you mean by exclusion, people? Exclusion means basically... What do you mean by the word exclusion? Exclusion of skilled workers. It's omission. It's basically not involving them, not allowing them to participate. But that is not the concern. The concern is basically, it is substitution. It is not, the author says you are replacing it. B is a better choice. And it is not in the development of automated technology. It is basically the processes that is getting replaced. Are you getting my point? So E is basically a misrepresentation. It is a misrepresentation of what is given in the passage. A typical CAT question would be like this. A typical CAT question would be like this. Something is given in the passage and they are going to change somewhat the meaning of it. And they will test you whether you have comprehended it or not. Take the next question, people. Which of the following best characterizes the function of the second paragraph of the passage? So go to the second paragraph. And this is the second paragraph. I hope you all can switch between the screens. Can you all switch between the screens, people? The sheet is there before you. You can download from the Facebook group. What is the function of the second paragraph, people? Someone has said B. Okay. It is comparison. Someone says comparison. Akshit says B. Ritual says. Okay, so A, G, B. Again, we have many options. By the way, what is happening in the first paragraph? Let's go here. Okay, now see. The paragraph here says, in automating, the industry moved to computer-based numerical control rather than artisan-generated RP. So the author says that the industry went to NC rather than RP. So RP was about labor and NC was about technology, right? And then what is happening in this passage, people? Although both systems reduced reliance on skilled labor, Noble preferred RP. NC did this. However, Noble's evidence of conspiracy is that. So it's all about RP and NC, right, people? It's all about RP and NC. Correct. So basically, I can say that the second paragraph is primarily about RP and NC. See how many times you get the word RP. RP, NC, and then how it is better, and then the management chose NC. From this, Noble concludes something else, right? So if I go to my options here, carefully listen to the first option now. It develops a topic introduced in the first paragraph. That means RC and RP and NC are introduced in the first paragraph, and it develops very much a good option. I don't have any reasons to eliminate this. So I will hold this for a while, people, until I find something better, correct? It provides evidence. Now, my point is, where is the evidence? And secondly, to refute a claim, what is the claim that is being refuted? You must look out for both. You must look out for the evidence and you must look out for the claim. There is no evidence in the passage. I mean, if you look at the second paragraph, the author is simply discussing what was RC and what was RP and what was NC. And then he says that RP was all about labor, NC was about technology, and management preferred NC because it was technology, and RP was somehow shown the door. So where is the evidence? I mean, if you say that he provides evidence, then you must show me the evidence. Evidence is something objective. Evidence is something objective. It is not, opinion is not an evidence. Opinion is testimony. Right, people? So again, B goes out because B does not hold good here. It gives examples of what is the phenomenon here mentioned in the first paragraph? RP NC itself is the phenomenon, and that same phenomenon has been discussed. RP NC itself is the phenomenon. So how can you give examples of that? I mean, RP NC is the phenomenon, and the same phenomenon has been discussed further. So where are the examples of RP and NC? RP NC, no examples. So the problem is that phenomenon is fine. But there are no examples because RPNC itself is a phenomenon, itself is a topic of discussion. Can I remove C, people? It does not present a generalization. Rather, the RPNC concept is discussed in detail. RPNC is the last sentence of the first paragraph, and the same RPNC has been discussed in detail, right, by the author. So how can I say it is generalizing something? It's basically building on that, right? So again, D goes out. Where are two possible solutions? Is the author suggesting solution? Or is the solution given in David Noble's book and the author is discussing that? He's not suggesting solution, people. By no means has the author suggested anything, so E goes out. So the best option is A. So did you see my approach, people? How I pick one option at a time, analyze it, and then finally pick. So this is the approach you must develop towards RC. You pick each and every option, analyze it carefully. You weigh it down, going by the evidence in the passage. And then finally, you say, okay, this is the best choice. Are we clear about it, people? Shall I go to the next question? The passage suggests which of the following about NC. What do you mean by suggest? Indirectly hinted. Indirectly, yes, not explicitly mentioned. Now, which of the following is? People say, Kunal says B. People, please go ahead and tell me what is the answer. People, please carefully read the paragraph. Only then you will come to the right answer. Don't rush. The biggest mistake we make in RC is we rush, and that is where people go wrong. You have to be very patient. You have to be very cautious. Let's go to the passage and see what the author has to say about NC, correct? It's about NC, correct? So where do you see NC? Much of the discussion has happened in the second paragraph, right? Although both systems reduced reliance on skilled labor. Both the systems reduced reliance on skilled labor. Which one did more? Is it given to you? The author says, both the systems reduced reliance on skilled labor. Both RP and NC reduced reliance on skilled labor. So if you come to the question, how can you say that it displaced fewer skilled workers? The number is not given. How can you say that this is fewer and the other is not? The numbers are not given to you, right, people? Are the numbers given to you anywhere? They both reduced reliance. That means both were equally good. Is it given that one was not good as one was not so good as the other? So how can you mark A, people? You will come across such questions in your mock test. You rest assured about it. And you will definitely go wrong like this. Correct, people? So can I remove A? Is it given that it was technically superior to RP? Is it given anywhere? Look at this now. Look at the passage, what it says here. It says here that although the two approaches, do you see this part of the passage? The two approaches were roughly equal in technical merit. If the two approaches were roughly equal in technical merit, which is explicitly given in the passage, then how can you say that it was technically superior? And where is the difficulty part of design given? So the best answer is C. It was designed without the active involvement of skilled machinists. The RP were basically, the RP was all about skilled labor and NC was all about engineers. Correct? Management chose NC, why? Because it was all about engineers. And therefore, to say it could have been implemented either by these people and or by these people, but the author has categorically said that the engineers could work only on NC and the machinists could develop RP. Where is it given that it could have been implemented by either of them? The best answer is C. Are we clear, people? Everyone is good with this? Shall we go to the next question? Why not A? Where is the number given to you? We have discussed this, Gauru, right? A short while back, I discussed. Didn't get it. Look at this part of the passage, Gauru. Look at this now. Both systems reduce reliance, right? Both systems reduce reliance on skilled labor. If they both reduce reliance, then they both were equally good, right? How can you say that one was better, it reduced more? How can you say it displaced fewer skilled workers then? People, take the fifth question quickly and tell me what is the answer without wasting. Which of the following phrases most clearly reveals the attitude of the author of the passage towards Noble's argument? So you must find that. By the way, the author's attitude is good or bad? The author's attitude towards Noble, it's bad, right? So you must pick out of these which is bad, right? How can you say C is the answer? C is very much positive. Who says conspired against? Noble in his book. Noble in his book says conspired against. So how can Noble's word reflect author's attitude? Conspired against is the phrase used by Noble in his book. It is not used by the writer of the passage. So how can you say that this phrase, which is written by Noble, expresses the author's attitude? The phrase must be written by the author, right? Even B is not written by the author. E is the only part, it is the only phrase that is written by the author. And there is no negativity in statement D. Statement D, there is no negativity. So how can you say that it is reflecting the author's attitude? The author's attitude towards Noble is negative, right? So you must pick the phrase which is negative. Clearly prefers is not a negative phrase. So even D goes out. C is a positive phrase. So how can it reflect the author's? Okay, let's go to clearly prefers now. We will go to clearly prefers and we will see. Where is clearly prefers? Noble clearly prefers RP with its inherent acknowledgement. So, although both systems reduced reliance on skilled labor, Noble clearly, is it a factual thing or is it something that is the author's opinion? Is this the author's opinion or is this the author's opinion? Which one is the author's opinion? Noble's only evidence of conspiracy is that, or Noble clearly prefers RP? This is what the author sees in the book. Okay, this is what the author sees in Noble's book, that Noble has preferred RP. And this is what the author has opinion about Noble. The author says Noble's only evidence of conspiracy is, that means basically the Noble has not been able to substantiate. Noble's only evidence of conspiracy basically means what? Noble has not been able to substantiate. Correct, people? And therefore, this is an opinion because you have not given me enough evidence. And this is basically what the author has seen in the passage, in the book. He says Noble prefers RP because of this thing. It's a factual thing. It's not an opinion. Noble clearly prefers basically means the author has seen in the book that yes, Noble has given preference to it. So the author's attitude is not reflected in clearly prefers. It is reflected in only evidence because that shows that the author is not, the author of the passage feels that Noble has not substantiated his claim. Are we clear about it, people? Shall we go to the next question? Comments means praise, people. When you commend someone, you praise that person. Commendable job. So the author of the passage commends Noble book. There is only one place in the passage where the author has commended. And that is straight away visible in the first paragraph. He says, Noble writes from Marx's perspective, and his central argument is that management conspired against labor. Noble fails to substantiate this claim, although his argument is impressive when he applies Marxist concept, right, of de-skilling. So the author has praised, his argument is impressive when he applies the Marxist concept of de-skilling. That means de-skilling is the only place where he praises Noble applying the concept of de-skilling. It's a factual question. You should not get such questions incorrect, people. If you get such questions incorrect, that means you are basically missing on the easiest of the easy questions. And then basically it's a very, very bad sign. That means you are really very, very poor in comprehension. Right, people? So if you have found the answer, should you discuss all these options? Does it make any sense to discuss all these options? It doesn't make any sense. Because the right answer is clearly visible in the passage. So why should you go by elimination? You simply skip everything else and move to the next question. Save your time. So if the author has categorically stated that although his argument of applying Marxist to the idea of de-skilling is categorically given, then he is the answer. There is no second thought to it. You will keep on looking for the passage to disprove this. But if this is proven, then there is no need for you to disprove all these things. So never fiddle when you have got the right answer. You straight away move to the next one. What is the seventh question, people? Tell me. Which of the following best characterizes forces of production, the book, not the passage? The first question was about the passage. This question is about the book. Right, people? Tell me what is the answer. Are we discussing the origin of a concept? And is it industrial economics? Or is it automation? I mean, are we discussing automation in the passage? I mean, is David Noble discussing automation in the passage, or is he discussing the concept of industrial economics? And is he discussing the origin? There are many questions which will put you in trouble if you mark answer B. A history of a particular industry from ideological point of view. What is that industry, people? What is that industry? The industry is machine tool industry, right? And what is the ideological point of view? Marxist point of view, correct. The author is discussing from Marxist perspective, and the very first sentence shows that. If you look at the very first sentence of the paragraph, it says here that Noble writes from Marxist perspective. That means the whole book, Forces of Production, is being discussed by Noble from Marxist perspective. So the ideology is quite clear to you. The third point is it a history or not? Noble examines the transformation. Now, transformation happens in a day or over a period of time? Transformation happens in a day or over a period of time? Yes, people, you answer this question. Any kind of transformation in an industry happens over in a day or over a period of time. It takes decade, right? So can I say it's a history? Can I say that it is a history of the machine tool industry from Marxist perspective? Isn't every word fitting the way it is in the passage? Noble is not pointing out any weakness. The author is pointing out weakness in Noble's book. The question is about the book, and the book is discussing automation. The passage is pointing out weakness in the book. Therefore, you shouldn't say that Forces of Production is a study that points out a weakness. The weakness is pointed out by the author of the passage, not by the book. And there are no industrial phenomena in different industries, so even E goes out. How can you say that an attempt to relate an industrial phenomena in one industry to a similar phenomena in another industry? Where is the other industry? Where is the other industry, and what is the phenomenon? It's out of scope. People, are we clear with this? How many of you got all correct? People, you must, this is the way, this is the sixth, Abhishek has done well. Abhishek, really, you're going good. And I'm seeing that you are coming three correct. Pulkit, not bad. But Gaurav has done well. Akshit also has done well. People, I think this was a good passage, right? It had many lessons to teach as to how to pick option, how to eliminate, right? We will take one more. We can take one more passage, right? Or are you all tired? I will read the passage for you. Analysis of prehistoric air trapped in tiny bubbles beneath the polar ice sheets and of the composition of surroundings those bubbles suggests. What suggests? Analysis of something. What are the two things that have been analyzed? Analysis of prehistoric air trapped and the analysis of the composition of the ice surrounding those bubbles, right? Suggest a correlation between carbon dioxide in the Earth's atmosphere and global temperature, right? Over the 160,000 years, right? Estimates of global temperature at the time the air in the bubbles was trapped rely on measuring the relative abundances of hydrogen and its heavier isotope deuterium in the ice surrounding the bubbles. When the global temperature are low, water containing deuterium tends to condense and precipitate before reaching the poles. Thus, ice deposited at the poles when the global temperature was cooler contained less deuterium than ice deposited at warmer global temperatures. Estimates of global temperature based on this information combined with the analysis of the carbon dioxide content, right, suggests that during periods of post-glacial warming, carbon in the Earth atmosphere increased by 40%. So it's a very simple passage, right? Now let's come to the question. In the passage, the author is primarily concerned with what? Is he describing a new method? Of estimating, or is he describing a method of analysis? Is he presenting information that suggests that global temperature has increased over the past 160,000 years? Is he presenting information? Or is he providing a method by which this can be known? Is he providing a method or is he presenting information? It's a method, right? Analysis suggests correlation. Estimates of global temperature rely on measuring relative abundances of hydrogen and deuterium. Correct? So basically, it is the method and not the information. So C can definitely go out. So if information goes out, how can you say describing the kinds of information? Do you see different kinds of information, people? You rule out information and then you say that there are kinds of information. Again, D goes out. Is he demonstrating the difficulty anywhere that it is difficult? No, difficulty point has not been at all discussed. So you are left with two options. One is A and the other is B. People, are you with me until here? So A says, describing a new method of estimating decreases in global temperature that have occurred and describing a method of analysis that provides information regarding the relation between the CO2 and global temperature. So it's the relation, right? So it says it's a method of analysis and it's not a new method estimating decreases. And basically you look at this, there is a correlation between what? Deuterium and hydrogen and temperature. So definitely the relationship word is more important. The analysis word is more important than saying. And secondly, is it a new method? How can we say that the method is new or old? So A goes out, B is the best choice. People, everyone is with me. The correlation is a very, very important word, people. And you have missed on that. The word correlation is very important because hydrogen and its isotope, the presence and the absence of it decides whether whether temperature is increasing or decreasing based on CO2. People, are we clear? Shall I go to the next question, people? I will take this next question here. I will come here and I will go to this because I want to see the question. It can be inferred from the passage that during periods of post-glacial warming, which of the following occurred? Post-glacial basically means after the cold part, you have after the glacial part, you have the post-glacial part, right? And post-glacial basically means warming. So what happened? People have marked, Saurav has marked A, Abhishek has marked B. So I will go back to the passage. I will go back to the passage and I will do the analysis here. Okay, just people hold on for a while. Okay, there is a correlation. Estimates, now we will read from the second statement. Okay, estimates of global temperature at the time air in the bubbles was trapped rely on measuring relative abundances of hydrogen and its heavier isotope deuterium. When global temperature are low, so when the temperature is low, so we'll draw an equation. When the temperature is low, right, water containing deuterium tends to condense and precipitate before reaching the poles. So when the temperature, thus ice deposited at the poles when the global temperatures are cooler contain less deuterium, right? So basically when the temperature is low, deuterium is low. When T is low, D is low. And when T is high, D is high, that is deuterium. Are we clear, people? Have we got this? So shall I go to the passage now and see where is the answer? Look at the answer now. So when the T went high, can I say that the deuterium deposited increased. That is what the equation we have derived, correct? If you look at this equation here, T decreases, D decreases, right? So definitely B becomes the obvious choice. The deuterium deposited at the poles increased. It is clearly visible to you, right? The total volume of air trapped, the total volume is the volume given to us. And when the warming happens, CO2 levels will increase. They will not decrease, people. It's not given correctly. C goes out. And hydrogen is given in the ice, but not in the Earth's atmosphere. So even D goes out. The rate is not known to us. E goes out. Isn't people B the best choice? Any doubt you have? Isn't it a good question? It's an inference. Why? Because it is nowhere given. Didn't we read between the lines? So this is the kind of reading between the lines you must do when you are writing your mocks, you are taking the... So it is, people understand, CAT, RC is all about doing good analysis. Shall I go to the next question, people? The third one. The author states that there is evidence to support which of the following assertions. There is evidence to support which of the following assertions. I mean, the moment you have understood the passage, C becomes a direct choice. Because you know that when there is warming, you can use your GK here. When the CO2 increases, when the carbon content increases, the temperature increases, right? So if there is post-glacial, that means basically what happens in post-glacial? The glacier melts. So 10,000 years ago, you had the ice ages, right? The melting happened, the temperature increased, the sea levels went up, right? So can I say that C is straight away the choice for me? Periods of post-glacial warming are characterized by the presence of increased levels of carbon dioxide. How is it given in the passage? I will go to the passage. Look at this now. Estimates of global temperature based on this information combined with analysis suggest that during periods of post-glacial warming, CO2 in the atmosphere has increased. Categorically, it is given. So can I say that during post-glacial warming, if CO2 increases, I mean, it is straight away given in the passage. How can you get such questions incorrect, people? Yes, any other question? A says estimates of global temperature that rely on measurements are more reliable than those based on. I mean, what is more reliable? What is less reliable? Nowhere given in the passage. Is the reliability factor anywhere discussed in the passage, people? So can we rule out A? Why not B? Deuterium is there in the ice, not in the Earth's atmosphere, people. Please understand. Deuterium is in the ice, not in the Earth's atmosphere. So this is again misrepresentation. B goes out. Yes, people, everyone is clear with this. D says increases in global temperature over the 160,000 years are largely the result of increase. Okay. I mean, the temperature has increased because of this, or this is basically this. There is some relation between the two. Is there a cause-effect relationship, or is there some kind of correlation? Is there a correlation between these two, or is there a cause-effect relationship? It's a correlation. It's not a cause-effect. The author has not said that because of high deuterium content, the temperature went high. He says that when the deuterium content is high, that means basically the temperature is high. There is a correlation between the two. I hope you're getting my point, people. The correlation has been brought out as cause and effect, and therefore D goes out. Again, it's a misrepresentation. Again, if D is going out, even E will go out, because it's the converse of what is given in D. Yes, people, everyone is with me, or are you? The conclusion given in the last sentence would have to be re-evaluated if which of the following were true. So it's a hypothesis that is being created, and you are basically asked to fit that hypothesis. Now, this is a very good question. What does the author say, people? The author says that when temperature is high, deuterium is high, right? And when deuterium is high, CO2 is high. And the so all these things are directly proportional, right? Now what happens in sea? Air bubbles trapped beneath the polar surface contain high levels of CO2 but low levels of deuterium. So if this happens, and when it happens, air bubbles trapped deep beneath the polar surface and containing high levels of CO2 are surrounded by ice that contain relatively low levels of deuterium. So if this becomes the case, then this equation, which has been the crux of the passage, is questionable, right? This is what the passage says, right? You increase T, that means D is increasing in the ice, and that means CO2 is increasing in the atmosphere, and that means basically CO2 content is high. So this is basically the relationship the author has given. All of a sudden, you discovered that when D goes down in the ice, CO2 in the water increases. And if CO2 in the water increases, that means it's quite possible that CO2 in the atmosphere must have increased. And D is decreasing. So the relationship which you have shown here, all of a sudden collapses. So wouldn't C make the entire hypothesis or the entire assertion of the author questionable? Yes or no, people? So definitely C stands out as one of the options. What about A? The amount of deuterium in ice deposited is greater. Where are the amounts discussed, people? Nowhere discussing, you know, it just goes out. Both the air bubbles trapped deep beneath the polar surface and the ice surrounding them contain. So fine, so it's a good thing. How this is correct, but how is it going to question the author's hypothesis? The air bubbles and the ice, they both contain low levels of deuterium, and this is what the author has said. So it is nowhere questioning the author's hypothesis. The author has said that if you analyze the air bubbles and the ice, then you will find that they contain low levels of deuterium. Fine, they contain low levels of deuterium. So how is it questioning the author's hypothesis? And same is the case with D. The current level of carbon dioxide in the Earth's atmosphere exceeds the level of CO2 in the prehistoric. Fine. That means the current level of CO2 is high, and therefore current temperature is high. And in the prehistoric days, the temperature was low, and therefore CO2 was low. So this is not, in fact, this is basically confirming the author's hypothesis. It is strengthening the author's assertion in the passage. It is not questioning. So D goes out. Increases in the level of carbon dioxide are accompanied by increases in the deuterium. The equation holds true. So what is given in the passage is basically reasserted by E. The passage says the same thing, right? You increase D and CO2 increases, and D is accompanied by increase in temperature. So again, you have the same relationship expressed in E. So how can E question the hypothesis? All go out except C. People, are we clear about it? Everyone is happy with this, or are you not? So that is for the day, people. It was almost one and a half hour. It's very tasking. So it's good, you know. My only point is that people, you must discuss the way we are discussing and analyzing. This is the kind of approach you must have while you take your RC. And if you do this, then I'm quite sure that out of 24 questions, you will not get less than 20 correct. You will not get less than 20 correct. And that means basically the verbal section is taken care of. You have to focus only on the other things. People, I have developed 100 RC passages with video solutions, okay? All 100 RC passages with complete video solution. Almost 500 videos only for RCs, okay? So, it's good if... that is available for that's a paid thing. It's a paid thing. I will forward the link. Okay, I will read the passage for you, and we will take the first question. First of all, I will read the passage, and this is the way I read. Increasingly, historians are blaming diseases imported from the old world for what? For the staggering disparity between the indigenous population of America, right, in 1492 and the few million full-blooded Native Americans alive at the end of the 19th century. So what do we get from these people? It says that historians are blaming diseases imported from the old world for what? for the staggering means huge, okay, for the staggering disparity between indigenous population, means native population, and the few million full-blooded Native Americans at the end of the century, 19th century. So the population in 1492 and the population at the end of 19th century, there was a staggering disparity, right? So this is what the author says about whose belief? Historians. The author says historians, the author is not giving his opinion. He says historians are blaming diseases imported from the old world. For what? For the staggering disparity. And then the author in the next sentence says there is no doubt that chronic disease was an important factor in, so whose opinion is this? There is no doubt that chronic disease was an important factor. Who says this? The author of the passage. So as I told you yesterday, people, that the author of the passage sometimes will quote someone else's opinion and sometimes he will quote his own opinion. So historians are blaming is the opinion of historians. And the author says there is no doubt that chronic disease was an important factor in the precipitous means basically steep, in the steep decline, and is highly probable that the greatest killer was epidemic disease, especially manifested in the virgin soil epidemics, right? This is what the author says, and then he goes on to the next paragraph. What does he say here? He says virgin soil epidemics are those in which the populations at risk have had no previous contact with disease that strike them and are therefore immunologically almost defenseless. So you must understand these kind of terms, people. The author says that this epidemic is a disease that strikes people who had no previous contact with that disease and therefore they are not immune to it. So if you contact malaria once, then you become immune to it. That means the next time you may not be affected by it, right? The author says that virgin soil epidemics were important in American history is strongly indicated by evidence that a number of dangerous malaria. So what is the author says? The author says that virgin soil epidemics were very common in diseases like smallpox, measles, malaria, and so on and so forth. Defects of their sudden introduction are demonstrated in the early chronicles of America. That means the author says that these diseases were suddenly introduced, right? From where? From the old world, correct? This is what the author says. So whatever the author says, he is very much in agreement with the historians, right? This is what you get to know, people, from the first few lines when you read the passage. Am I not clear? The historians are blaming the diseases imported from the old world, and the author more or less agrees with them, right? The author is basically supporting the historians, right? The author says that the effects of their sudden introduction are demonstrated. So when the author says the effects of their sudden introduction are demonstrated in the early chronicles of America, he is basically supporting what the historians have said. Historians are blaming diseases. And the author says there is no doubt that chronic disease was an important factor. And then he goes and starts giving evidence as to how it was an important factor. He says that the evidence provided by the documents of British and French colonies is not as definitive because the conquerors of those areas did not establish permanent settlement until the 17th century, right? Even so, and then in the next paragraph, the author says, even so, the surviving records of North America do contain references to deadly epidemics. So again, the author is giving evidence that surviving records of North America gives references to deadly epidemics among the indigenous, means native population of America. In 1616-19, an epidemic possibly of bubonic or pneumonic plague swept coastal New England, killing as many as 9 out of 10. During 1630 smallpox, the disease most fatal to the Native American people, eliminated half the population, right? In 1820s, fever devastated the people of Columbia River. So what is the author saying? That certain diseases did kill the indigenous people. And then the author says, unfortunately, the documentation of these is slight and frequently unreliable. Slight means what? Minute. I mean, it's not a strong proof, and that's why it is unreliable. And it is necessary to supplement what little we do know with evidence from recent epidemics, right? For example, in 1952, an outbreak of measles among the Native American measles among the Native American inhabitants affected 99% of the people and killed 7%, even though some had the benefit of modern. So in spite of having the modern benefit, it affected 99% of the people. Cases such as this demonstrate that even diseases that are not fatal can have devastating consequences when they strike an immunologically defenseless community. So what is the main idea of the passage? Before I go to the question, how many people can tell me what is the passage all about? You just write your summary in the comment box. I want to see what you have understood. What is the most frequently, which word have you come across most frequently in this passage, people? It's all right, Abhishek, it's all right. The word disease, if you read the passage, then the word disease is the most frequently occurring word, right? What kind of disease, people? Chronic disease. And this disease has come from which place? This disease has affected it. It has affected what? Whom it has it affected? This disease has affected whom? America or Americans or Native Americans? It has affected the Native Americans, not just American people. Please understand. When you say America, it means people who have migrated to America are to also come into that. So there are certain diseases which has affected the Native Americans, right? And what are those diseases? Virgin soil epidemics, right? Correct, people? These diseases, the author has used the term virgin soil epidemics, right? So what is the author doing in the passage? The author says that there is something called as virgin soil epidemic. He says that the American Indians have been affected by it, right? So what is he trying to do in the passage? Isn't he giving evidence all the while? The author is not analyzing. The author is giving evidence. He is supporting. Look at this now. I will give you evidence now. The effects of their introduction are demonstrated in the early chronicles, right? This is the evidence, right? The early chronicles are the evidence. The evidence provided by the documents is not so good. The Spanish is very good. The surviving records of North America contain references. During 1630, smallpox. During 80s, fever devastated. So the author is giving examples right throughout the passage. Correct, people? What are these examples doing? Why is he giving all these examples? People, listen to all my questions, because these questions will make you think. Why the author is giving all these examples? The author is giving all these examples because he wants to support that, yes, the diseases did kill many people. Right? And where do we get evidence for that? If you look at the first paragraph, you get the evidence. Historians are blaming diseases imported from the old world. And they are blaming for what? For the staggering disparity between the population in 1492 and the population at the end of the 19th century. And the author says there is no doubt that chronic disease was an important factor. And what is he doing? He is saying why there is no doubt. Now let's come to the first question, people. And here lies the magic. What is the primary? Good. Provide support. Correct? He is providing support, right? He is not suggesting a solution. If he has suggested a solution, then can you tell me what solution has he suggested? And where is the dilemma, people? There is nowhere a dilemma visible in the passage. So can I say option D goes out? There is no dilemma. If you say there is dilemma, that means there is some kind of confusion. Then where is the dilemma? The historians say that the diseases imported from the old world are responsible for disparity. And the author says, yes, they are responsible. So where is the dilemma? So B goes out. Is he reconciling opposing viewpoints? If there are any opposing viewpoints, where are these viewpoints? I don't see them. He's not and there is no opposing viewpoint. So how can you question the reconciliation or the conciliation of that? People, all, can you all hear me? Okay. So we have removed two options. Is he analyzing or is he supporting? What is the main function in the passage? Is the author doing more of analysis or the author is providing evidence throughout the passage, right? The author is providing evidence throughout the passage. So he is supporting rather than analyzing. Because when you analyze, yes, he is supporting because the evidence is explicitly visible. He is not, where is the misconception if you say there is no misconception, so A goes out. B is the answer. Now many of you might ask me, why is it a hypothesis? Many of you might ask me, why is it a hypothesis, right? If the author is so sure about it, why is it a hypothesis, people? What is a hypothesis? Hypothesis is unproven theory. It's a conjecture. It's an unproven theory, right? So why is this passage a hypothesis, people? Shall I go to the passage back? Why is it a hypothesis? Do you see the last sentence of the paragraph? The first sentence of the last paragraph? Unfortunately, the documentation of these and other epidemics is slight and frequently unreliable. So the evidence is there, but it is unreliable. If the evidence is unreliable, then how can you say that you are 100% sure about it? That means basically it's a hypothesis. Why? Because it is yet to be confirmed. The hypothesis is that, yes, hypothesis is that the evidence is there, but the evidence is unreliable. And because the evidence is unreliable, the theory is not yet confirmed, and therefore this is a hypothesis. People, everyone is happy with this question? Here is the passage and here is the question. I hope you all can see the question. Please take the second question. What is the answer? When the author is, or the author is analyzing, when he goes into the minute discussion of cause and effect, when he gets into minute discussion of cause and effect, that is analysis. He's breaking things down into bits and pieces. So when there is more of reasoning, then there is analysis. What is the answer for the second question, people? According to the passage, virgin soil epidemics can be distinguished from other outbreaks in that virgin soil epidemics involve populations with no exposure to a disease, right? So where do you see this answer, people? If you come to the question again, look at the second paragraph, right? Virgin soil epidemics are those in which the population at risk have had no previous contact, right? Isn't it a factual question, people? The answer is clearly given to you. Involve populations with no prior exposure. So can I say that this is the easiest of all questions? Should you get such questions incorrect? No, you should not. You must ensure that when you come across such questions, you get it right. Okay? Let me go to the third question now. So you will have a mixed variety. According to the passage, the British colonists were unlike the Spanish colonists. In that, the British colonists, in that basically means for the reason. In that basically means for the reason that. Okay? So when you see such phrases in that, it means for the reason that. So how would you say? The British colonists were unlike the Spanish colonists for the reason that. The British colonists, what will come next? And the answer is given in the passage, you know, clearly visible. Just see and check me if you can find it. Yes. So people have marked, it says they kept records from a very early date. So look at this. The British colonists kept record from a very early date, right? Let me go to that part of the passage and let me see if they are. Look at this now. The effect, the evidence provided by the documents of British and French colonies is not as definitive because the conquerors of those areas did not establish, that means British did not establish permanent settlement. That means they came late. People, I hope you are getting this Look at this now. The effects of their sudden introduction are demonstrated in the early chronicles of America, which contain reports of horrendous epidemics and steep population declines, confirmed in many cases by Spanish records. The evidence provided by the British and French documents are not definitive because the conquerors did not establish permanent settlement until the 17th century. That means who came first, people? Did the Spanish came first or did the British came first? Answers, please. Who came first? The Spaniards came first, right? Because there is something in the Spanish record, and the British and French records are not as definitive because they were not kept until the 17th century. That means they were kept after 17th century, and that means they must have arrived late. So how can you mark B, which says that the British colonists kept record from a very early date? You are comparing the British record with the Spanish, right? And the Spaniards came first. So B goes out. I hope you all have got it. Why B goes out? People, yes or no? Let me come to the answer. I will come to the answer. But did you get why B goes out? B goes out. Who came first, people? This is for Goro. Who came first? The Spanish came first or the British came first? If the Spanish came first, then how can the British keep records from a very early date? The British came later, right? And the author says that the Spanish record is better than the British. Why? Because the British started keeping records only after 17th century. That means the Spaniards must have kept record before 17th century. I hope people you are following me. You must read these lines. Look at what these lines say. The effects of there is the diseases. The effects of the sudden introduction are demonstrated in the early chronicles of America, right? Confirmed in many cases by the Spanish tribute records. The evidence provided by British and French is not as definitive. As definitive as what? As definitive as the Spanish. Because the conquerors of those areas did not establish permanent settlement and began to keep continuous record until the 17th century. Who were the conquerors? The British and French were the conquerors of their areas. The Spanish were the conquerors of their areas. People, I hope you are following me. So what do we get from this? The Spaniards came first. They maintained the record. The British and the French came later. They maintained record only after 17th century. People, are we clear about it? Are you getting where this question is going? Look at this. Look at this, people. Look at these lines now. Furthermore, the British tended to drive the native populations away rather than enslaving them as the Spaniards did. So where is the answer? The Spaniards enslaved, the British drove away. So where is the answer? C is the answer. The British colonists, look at this, the British colonists is the concern, not the Spaniards. The British colonists were unlike the Spanish colonists because the British colonists drove the Americans away, the Spaniards enslaved the native population, and therefore E goes out. People, this is the kind of things you will get in your CAT exam. And if you don't study good questions, you will never learn what a good question is. Now, the answer to the previous question is there here in the fourth one. Which of the following can be inferred from the passage concerning Spanish tribute records? What can we infer about Spanish tribute records? Now, you have to go to the passage where you see something about Spanish tribute records and see what can you infer from that. The way you nail it, they were kept prior to the 17th century. Very good. The author says that we come to know something about Spanish tribute records. They are more reliable than the French, and I will spot that area in the passage where you can see this. Look at now. This is precisely where it is given here. The effects of the sudden introduction are, there refers to diseases. The effects of the disease's sudden introduction are demonstrated in the early chronicles of America, which contained reports of horrendous epidemics, right? Confirmed in many cases by what? Analysis of Spanish tribute record, right? The evidence provided by British and French is not as definitive because they were not kept until the 17th century. That means the Spanish tribute is reliable because it was kept before the 17th century. That is what the inference is, right, people? So they were being kept prior to the 17th century, people. I hope you got it, people, why it is a good question. This question is in fact tougher than the third one. The third one was categorically given in the passage. This you had to infer. People, everyone is clear why the answer is C. Let's go to the next question, the fifth one. The author implies which of the following about measles? Yes, what is the answer, people? I think this too is a straightforward question. You can go to the part of the passage where you can see measles and you can guess the answer. Please go and check, people. Go and check. Before you mark the answer, you must give a second thought. Where exactly is it given? I will go to the passage again. Okay, I will just drag this up and I will show you where the answer lies. Look at this. Read these lines, people. You will get to know. It says, for example, in 1952, an outbreak of measles among the Native American inhabitants affected 99% of the population. So, outbreak of measles affected 99% of the population, even though some had benefit of modern medicine. Cases such as this refers to what? The previous case, demonstrate that even diseases that are not normally fatal. Which disease is it referring to? Measles, right? Isn't it, people? Yes or no? So can I say that the answer to the question is direct and straightforward, and the answer is A. It is not usually a fatal disease. The author implies which of the following about measles. It is not usually a fatal disease. It ceased to be a problem by 17th century. If it ceased to be a problem, then how can in the 1960s it strikes people? It goes out. It was not a significant problem in the Spanish colonies. Nowhere it is given, people. Someone marked C, right? It is the disease most commonly involved in. I mean, it is a virgin soil epidemic, but is it most commonly involved in virgin soil and not at other places? See, the moment you say it is the disease most commonly involved, that means basically it is most commonly found in this and not others. Why not D? It was not a significant problem in the Spanish colonies. How can you say this? When you say the author implies, that means the hint is given, right? So where is the hint for statement D? If you say that D is the answer, then you must go and find it where exactly is the author implying. It was not a significant problem in the Spanish colonies. The word measles has come only at two places in the paragraph. It comes at the start. When you look at the start, it says here, right? Virgin soil epidemics are those in which the population at risk have had no previous contact, right? And that virgin soil epidemics were important is strongly indicated by evidence that a number of dangerous maladies, right? Measles is mentioned here, were unknown in the pre-Columbian New World. That means measles was not known to Native Americans. It was known to them only after 1492, when the disease came from the Old World. So this is the first time the word measles has come. And the second time the word measles has come is in the last paragraph. And the last paragraph categorically says that cases such as this demonstrate that diseases that are not normally fatal. That means basically measles is not normally fatal. If you read these four lines, then you get to know that normally measles is not a fatal disease. But in certain cases, if there is no immune system in the body, I mean, if the body is not immune to it, then it might become fatal. So how can you say that the answer to the question fifth could be D when there is not the slightest of hint in the passage? People, when you mark an answer, you must see evidence. Without evidence, You should not accept a right answer as a right answer. For C, I have shown, for option A, I have shown the evidence. For any other, if you see the evidence, you must go ahead. So people, you must develop one thing in verbal aptitude, and that is always strictly go by evidence. You don't see the evidence, you don't believe in me. You don't believe in any other person. If you see the evidence, then you believe in yourself. It must be the right evidence backed by the right logic. Shall I go ahead, people? Okay, now take the sixth question. What can be inferred? Which of the following can be inferred from the passage about Native American inhabitants of Ungava Bay? So you go to Ungava Bay, you have a look at and see what exactly they have to say. This also is a simple question. You go back to the passage. Where is Ungava Bay mentioned? It is mentioned towards the end, right? It says here that, for example, in 1952, an outbreak of measles among the Native American inhabitants of Ungava Bay affected 99% of the population, even though some had benefit of modern medicine. Cases such as this demonstrate that even diseases that are not fatal can have devastating consequences when they strike an immunologically defenseless community. That means the community at Ungava was immunologically defenseless. A disease like measles can be fatal if it strikes immunologically defenseless community. And the author has says cases such as this. That means this is the case. That means people in this case were immunologically defenseless. That means basically, please take the seventh question and the eighth question, people. Just give me a minute. Please take the seventh and the eighth question. Answer to the seventh question, people. The author mentions 1952 outbreak of measles in order to. So we have to go to the passage and see why exactly has the author mentioned this. Now look at the last paragraph. The author says, for example, correct? For example, in 52, an outbreak of measles. So if the author gives examples by using the word an outbreak of measles, that means there must be some reasons as to why the author has used this term. Correct? So it says that, unfortunately, the documentation of these and other epidemics is slight and unreliable. And it is necessary to supplement what little we do know with evidence from recent epidemics. That means he wants to supplement whatever we do know with evidence from recent. That means what is the purpose? To strengthen something, right? The word corroborate means to strengthen, to support. So you must know the meaning of the word to arrive at the right answer. To support the documentary evidence of epidemic disease in colonial America. Because the old evidence is unreliable. And the author says, to basically come to any firm conclusion, you must support it with current events of such diseases. And that's why he is trying to say, for example, we must study the 1952 measles. I think this is very much a simple. He's not trying to refute and he's not challenging any assumption. So these two go out. And the purpose is not to demonstrate the impact of modern medicine. Modern medicine has been just tangentially mentioned. What is tangentially? It is not taking the main issue. The main issue is that people who are defenseless immunologically, even if they have access to modern medicine, they are vulnerable to it. So the point of contention is not that modern medicines are effective or not, but he's trying to say that if we study some, because the word for example gives you the hint, right people? The word for example gives you the hint. So everyone is happy with B. Shall we go to the next question, people, without any further delay? This is the best question. And I think one of the question that will test your understanding. Please tell me what is the answer. You have a minute. People, I will read the question. Which of the following, if discovered, newly discovered, would most seriously weaken the author's argument? What is the author's argument? The author's argument is about the population number of, what is the number of population? I mean, the population figures. the author's argument is the population figures, or is it the diseases played an important role in depopulation? What is the author's argument? That diseases played an important role in depopulation, right? So can you say that A would weaken because A does not talk about the diseases? A says the evidence setting the pre-Columbian population, but the problem is these two will weaken the argument. But what is the author's argument? What is the question? The question is to weaken the author's argument concerning what? Concerning the importance of virgin soil epidemics. That means basically, irrespective of the population, the epidemic played an important role as per the author. You have to weaken that point. If you mark A, you're not weakening the argument because you're not talking about virgin soil epidemics. What about D people? Did you see D? Did you understand D? What is the passage all about? The passage says that until 1492, right, certain diseases were not there in America. After 1492, when Columbus discovered America and the Europeans came to America, they brought certain diseases from the old world, right? The old world refers to Europe and Asia. So, from the old world, the settlers brought the diseases, and because the Native Americans had no contact with those diseases, they were immunologically defenseless. And after that, the population went down from 1492. It came to some few million by the end of the 19th century, right? Is this the point, right, people? So what is the author's key argument? That before 1492, the Native Americans were not in contact with the virgin soil epidemic diseases. But if we find fossils that indicates that Native American contact with smallpox was there prior to 1492, then the entire hypothesis that the diseases came from the old world collapses. What is the theory, people? The theory is that the diseases from the old world played an important role in the massive population decline. But if fossils are found indicating that smallpox was there prior to 1492, then the entire theory that the diseases from the old world played a role in bringing down the population collapses. People, are you following this logic? And Spanish tribute records showing periodic fluctuations, how is it going to weaken? I mean, if it shows this is also periodic fluctuation, right? The population is effectively going down, but this is showing periodic fluctuation. And secondly, how can you say that the virgin soil epidemics were not responsible for depopulation? You must strike straight. Remains of French settlements dating back to 16th century. It's all right, but how is it proving that virgin soil epidemic did not play a role? People, the question is most seriously weaken the argument. So even if the French settlement goes back to the 16th century, that's fine. How can you say that the epidemic did not play a role in depopulation? So for a while you say, okay, fine. Yes, there are remains of French settlements dating back to E. That would not weaken seriously. E would not weaken seriously. See, you must weaken basically means you must throw the argument outside the window. When you say I want to weaken your argument, I must throw your argument outside the window. So I keep on telling that the diseases from the old world played a role, and then you find evidence that these diseases existed before 1492. So my argument is out. But if the French settlement is in the 16th century and I say it is in the 18th century, then what? How is it weakening the point that virgin soil epidemics were not responsible? I hope people are getting how to strongly weaken something. It's again a very good passage. Please take, it's a very short passage. Hardly it has 2 paragraphs. But the questions are really good. The questions are really good. Don't go by the length of the passage, people. They are very deceptive. Size is deceptive. Long passages might have very simple questions and short passages might have very, very difficult questions. Okay? Please take this. Okay, let's take this question now, people. I will read the passage for you, and we will work on this comparing designs in music with visual designs raises interesting questions. We are familiar with easy transfers of terms denoting qualities from one field to another. The basic problem can be put this way: can music sound the way a design looks? The elements of music are not the same as those of painting. They may be analogous, but to be analogous is not to be identical. Is it possible then for the same broad characteristics to emerge from different perceptual conditions? What is one perceptual condition? One is of the ears and the other is of the eyes, right? So music is of the ears and eyes is of painting, correct, people? So the author says, is it possible for the same broad characteristics to emerge from two facts about the relation between broad characteristics of a work and their perceptual condition must be kept distinct. The first, the global characteristics of a visual or auditory complex are determined by the discernible parts and their relationships. So what is it? People, please understand this. The global characteristics of visual or auditory complex are determined by what? Discernible parts. Thus, any notable change in the parts produces a change in the global characteristics. Secondly, a change in the parts may leave other global characteristics unchanged. Okay, fine. So I will not get very deep into it. Let's look at the first question. In the first paragraph, the author is primarily concerned with the question says only about the first paragraph, not the second paragraph. So please don't answer the question keeping the whole passage in mind. You have to answer the question keeping only the first paragraph. And what is the first paragraph all about? The first paragraph says comparing designs in music with designs raises interesting questions. What are those questions? We are familiar with the easy transfers of terms, right? The basic problem can be built this way. Can music sound the way a design looks? The elements of music are not the same as those of painting. They may be analogous. What do you mean by analogous? They might be comparable, but they're not identical. So what do you mean by that? Comparisons are not equations, right? Auditory phenomena and visual phenomena are just examples the author has taken. People, please understand this. Auditory phenomena and visual phenomena is the example the author has taken, and the example is not the main idea. The main idea is that the elements of music are not the same as those of painting. They might be analogous, but to be analogous is not to be identical. Then what he says, is it possible then for same broad characteristics to emerge from different perceptual conditions? Comparing designs in, and secondly, how can you say they are not visual phenomena? I mean, the author says auditory phenomena are not visual phenomena. He's trying to compare them. He says, let's compare them. They are analogous. They are not equal. And the author is basically focusing on the comparison and not on the phenomena. Look at the second sentence. We are familiar with the easy transfers of terms denoting qualities from one field to another. The first field the author has taken is music, and the second field he has taken is painting. And the focus is on the fields. I mean, it could be any field. Comparison is not equation. That's what he says. The elements of music are not the same as those of painting. They may be analogous. So he says that they may be analogous, but they are not identical, and therefore comparisons are not equations is the focus, and not auditory phenomena are not visual phenomena. I mean, he says that they might be they are comparable, but they are not similar. So I would have chosen option B if option B would have been like this. Auditory phenomena might be comparable to visual phenomena, but they are not identical. If B option had been like this, then I would have chosen option B. The others go out. Frequently used comparisons are usually inaccurate. How can you say frequently used? Has this been mentioned by the author, frequently used or infrequently used? Careless perceptions. Questions are psychological. They all go out, right? So it is easy for you to eliminate E, D and C. Then it all boils down to A and B. You must understand that is the auditory and visual just an example or is it the crux of the pattern? And from the second paragraph, you can make that out, people. The second paragraph is not at all focusing on audio or visual. It is focusing on basically the broad characteristics of a phenomena. It says perceptual conditions. That means the author had taken visual and auditory just as a random example. Let's go to the next question, people. In the passage, the author is primarily concerned with what? Distinguishing mutually exclusive categories. So you can shortlist A. You can shortlist D. Are there any opinions, people? And if there are opinions, the author is giving only his own opinion. He is not giving anyone else's opinion, people. See, when you say opinions, you must have more than one opinion. And the only opinion I see in the entire passage is the opinion of the author. So he is not comparing opinions as if opinion A is of one person and opinion B is of the other person. There is no, the author simply says, you know, he is speaking in his own tone, right? So there are no more than one opinion. E goes out. Now, people, let's have a look at this, people. Okay, I think I'm there, don't worry. Distinguishing mutually exclusive categories. What are the points of distinction? If there is any distinguishing, then what are those points of... Or is he analyzing a problem? See, the author says that they may be analogous, but to be analogous is not to be identical. Is it possible then for the same broad characteristics to emerge from different? So he's trying to what? He's asking a question. What is the question, people? Is it possible for the same broad characteristics to emerge from different perceptual conditions? That means there are two different perceptual conditions. And he's trying to find, he's analyzing a problem. The problem is basically, is it possible for the same broad characteristics to emerge from different perceptual conditions? Two facts must about the relation between the broad characteristics. See, the author is primarily concerned with what? He's analyzing a problem, and the problem is basically that can we have same broad characteristics from different perceptual conditions? And that's why he says they may be analogous, but they are not identical. And then he says two facts about the relation between broad characteristics of a work and their perceptual conditions must be kept distinct. So the second paragraph is not at all any... See, the point, people, is that he is analyzing a problem. And what is the problem? The problem is, the basic problem can be put this. Look at the second sentence, people. The basic problem can be put this way. Can music sound the way design looks? Is it possible? The first question is what? Can music sound the way design looks? The second question is, is it possible for the same broad characteristics to emerge from different perceptual conditions? So he is basically analyzing a question mark. He has not given the answer, people. He says that the basic problem can be put this way. Can music sound the way design looks? Has he given the answer, people? If you say that the basic problem can be put this way, can music sound the way design looks? Has he given the answer to this question? Then how can you say that he is distinguishing mutually exclusive categories if there is no answer? He is analyzing the problem. Music intersection painting is good as per the author. Answer is very true. The author is trying to basically draw similarities between two phenomena, and he's asking the question, are they comparable? Can we draw similar things from two different perceptual conditions? So the problem is, the moment you mark option A, You have to say that, are they mutually exclusive? On the one hand, the author is trying to draw similarities. And when you mark the answer, you say they are mutually exclusive. So if the author wants to say they are mutually exclusive, then basically he must answer the question. He has given, very true, Abhishek is right, he hasn't given the answer. And that's why he's analyzing a problem, because the answer is yet to come. And what you do when you mark A, you are giving the answer that yes, he is distinguishing. You in A, you say that they are mutually exclusive. You have already given the answer when the author has not given the answer. When you say that they are mutually exclusive, then what is the point of asking this question? Is it possible for the same broad characteristics to emerge from different perceptual conditions? So on the one hand, you ask, is it possible the same broad characteristics to emerge from different perceptual conditions? And then you basically say, yes, they are mutually. Yes, people, did you get this question? It's a difficult question, but D is the answer. It's a very difficult question, but it's a very, very good question. The author has not given the answer, and option A gives the answer. Let's go to the next one. The second paragraph is primarily concerned with what? I will go to this part of the equation here. The second paragraph is primarily concerned with what? So where do you see second paragraph? This is the second paragraph. So you can refer to your sheet. Here is the second paragraph and here is the question. Let's discuss it quickly. Now look at the second paragraph. I will read this for you people. Two facts about the relation between broad characteristics of a word and their perceptual conditions must be distinct. First, the global characteristics of a visual or auditory complex are determined by the discernible parts and their relationship. So he says that the global characteristics are determined by the discernible parts. Any notable change in the parts produces a change in the global characteristic. Second, a change in the parts leave the other characteristics unchanged. Means some change changes the global characteristics and some change does not change the global characteristic, right? This is what the passage says in short. What is the best answer? How can you say they are isolated? He says that certain global characteristics, a certain change in the parts changes the global characteristic, right? So how can you say changes in the parts of a work remain isolated? D goes out. Right. It can remain isolated. You cannot say confidently that it will remain isolated. He says changes in the parts of a work remain isolated, right? So can remain because sometimes change in the part may not change the global characteristic. So D goes out. Look at this answer. The parts of a work influence the total perception of the work. The part of the work influence what? The global perception. B is the choice. B is the right option. Different global characteristics come from the same parts, not given anywhere. A goes out. Visual and auditory characteristics can be combined. Where is the combination part has come? Not even given here. In the second paragraph, we are not discussing visual and auditory phenomena. The second paragraph is basically global characteristics and parses out. B is the best choice. The only choice that makes some sense. Yes, people, everyone is following me. I hope we are all on the same. Take the fourth question, people. Which of the following statements is most likely to be a continuation of the passage? The simplest evidence is that the second paragraph is not about music and painting. The second paragraph is not about music and painting. Very good. Simple question. The author says in the paragraph that two facts about the relation must be kept distinct. The first is this, the second is this, and then he says towards the end that the search for broad similarities thus begins, because he's trying to find broad similarities, right, people? If you look at the last sentence of the first paragraph, he says, can we draw broad similarities? And he says the search for broad similarities thus begins by understanding and distinguishing these two facts. Which two facts? Change in the global part. Change in the part affects the global whole, and change in the whole, some changes may not affect, right? So these two facts are the facts discussed immediately before. A is the best choice. Yes, people, any doubts you have in these questions? What was the overall difficulty, people? The first one, basically, the first question, or the first option? When you say first one again, first question, when you go to the first question, people, this is the one, right? In the first paragraph, the author is primarily concerned with. This is the question, right? I hope you all can see this. So when you compare auditory and visual phenomena, you don't mean to say they are equal. You mean to say they are comparable. Equation means identical, you know, that auditory is equal to visual. But the author says that when I'm comparing, I don't say they are equal. That's what he says, you know. The elements of music are not the same as those of painting. They may be analogous, but to be analogous is not to be identical. What is analogous, people? Analogous basically means comparable. But comparison is not equation. See, point, the point here is, you must understand this, that the punch of the first paragraph is towards proving this, or towards saying that comparison. See, he says comparing designs raises interesting questions. Right? We are familiar with easy transfers of terms denoting qualities from one field to another. The basic problem can be put this way. Can music sound the way design looks? The elements of music are not the same as those of painting. They may be analogous. That means basically he says that unable to analyze questions and compare. See, people, these are very tough questions. You know, I would say that unable to analyze questions and compare it with the paragraphs the way you did. How did you get better at? See, people, I have been teaching a lot. I have been teaching GRE, GMAT, CAT. So my point is that you must become a cautious reader, and that caution must come depending on whether you are what kind of question you are trying to solve. See, there are questions in which you have to go to the passage, find that particular word and start looking out for the answer. And there are questions in which you have to understand the entire passage broadly. So there are questions which need specific. Yes. GMAT is harder than CAT any given day. CAT is nowhere close to GMAT when it comes to verbal, people. I have been teaching, and I have many of my students have gone to ISB Hyderabad. I can tell you that GMAT is a real nut when it comes to verbal. Yes, GMAT verbal is very difficult. Anyways, people, let's come to this point now. So when you say that what kind of reading you need, you must look at the question. Does the question demand specific section? Does the question demand reading specific section of the passage, or does the question demand reading the entire passage and getting an understanding of it? This is where you must decide whether you should go to a specific part and carefully read it, or whether you must read the whole passage broadly and try to find the answer. So when you look at question like what is the central idea of the passage, the answer is not given anywhere. You must have a broad understanding of the passage. But if the question comes, what can be inferred about the Spanish tribute record, then you must go to the Spanish tribute record, read 2-3 lines above and below, and definitely you will come across the answer. In that case, there is no need for you to read the entire passage. So you must be wise enough whether to read the entire passage to get the answer, or whether you should read only that section of the passage where you think the answer is hidden. And that is what you must develop in yourself over a period of time. whether you should read the entire passage or you should read only one section of the passage and thereby save time. Yes, but then question should be read first. Don't do it outrightly, people. At the start, you first get it. The first reading should be of the entire passage. You must get an understanding of the passage. What is it all about? Is it too difficult? Is the subject matter very heavy? Is it a very simple passage? What is the author trying to do? So the first reading must be completed within 50-60 seconds. And then you go to the question. And then based on the question, you do the reading depending on whether the question needs the proper understanding of the passage or whether the question needs a specific section to be understood. So what I do, I always read the passage first just to get understanding as to what the passage is. I don't even know what the passage is and I am reading the question. So first you read the passage, try to understand something of it, if not everything. And then you go to the first question and then it's your choice. Depending on the question, you can either go to the specific section of the passage or you can read the entire passage again, because you know that the passage is something which you may not be able to answer without having a complete understanding. Okay, people, so this was all. We have spent almost 1 hour, 20-25 minutes, and I think we should not take RCS for more than 1 hour, 1.5 hour, because it gets very boring and tedious. I mean, I find it really, you have to speak so much. But anyways, it was a good session, people. I hope you all enjoyed it, because the questions were difficult. But this is where the learning happens. When the questions are tough, the learning multiplies. Yes, my throat needs rest. Okay, people, do recommend this to others, and I would highly recommend people. I mean, I don't like to this, but my suggestion is that people, I have 100 RCs. Yes, do RC daily. I have 100 RCs with video solutions, right? So people, if you're really interested, then you know, I would say that you go for it, because I have put in my heart and soul into it. 100 RC passages with complete video solutions. Yes. My entire 100 RCs are very difficult, and I have seen people's scores improving a lot. Last year, most of my students have really done well. It's not that I am trying to promote my thing, but it's because I'm really concerned, and as a teacher, I would say that if I have to recommend something, then I would definitely say that if you're having issues with the verbal section, particularly the RC, if you want to strengthen that, you go for my the RC is really very good. It's top notch, and that the RC includes 100 critical reasoning questions as well. So it has 600 videos, 500 for RCs and 100 for critical reasoning. It is more than enough. It is more than enough, and the charges are minimal, and that will also help you. Attend my, because you need something good to practice. There is no point practicing lots of things and eventually you don't get anything out of it. That's fine, but see, it all depends upon how comfortable. I mean, are you learning something? Are you really able? Are you enjoying the explanations? Are you able to understand this? See, you might refer to any book, that is your choice, but then are you able to gain from it? Are you able to learn from it? That is the big question. No, I don't have any PDF. It is just 1600. It includes 600, 500 RC questions. In a sense, 500 RC questions plus 100 CR. All videos. People, it's just 1599. And that will also give you access to all my RC sessions as well. I mean, critical reasoning. And the videos are top notch, and it's all ready. I mean, you can look for the quality. almost 9 of my students have crossed the 99.4 percentile barrier last year, going through the material. So it is really very good. I'm telling you, if you really think that you need something, then go for it. If you already have something, there's no need. The RC sessions, I would take RC sessions, but I cannot take more.